Welcome to the Just Be a Man podcast, where we offer commentary from a man's perspective. As always, be sure to check us out on our various social media platforms, Facebook, IGTV, YouTube, you name it. We'd like you guys to get in there and subscribe, like, share, and just make sure, you know, if you like what you see, you know, get it out there so that others can partake as well. And pick up some merchandise while you're at it, guys. We have some great items for sale on our website, which is www.jbampod.com. And you could pick up some t-shirts, some cups, sweatshirts, things of that nature. And all the proceeds go to a very worthwhile cause of sending some folks to HBCUs, including our own kids. So
real quick.
Now, if y'all interrupt me one more time. Now, guys, everyone knows that growing old is a blessing, right? But slowly but surely, especially at our age, we start losing the people that we love. I'm talking grandparents, great aunties, uncles, things of that nature, people we went to school with. So that's right. So which brings us to tonight's topic, where we're talking about preparing for the inevitable, getting our financial lives in order. So I'm your man, Charles, and tonight we have the usual cast of characters. We have Chuck.
That's me.
Mike. Stefan.
Yes, sir.
And Wayne.
What's going on, everybody?
And joining us this evening is the CEO of Game On Capital, longtime friend of the show. This brother goes back to Punk Ass Kids 1. That's when he started following us. So this is Mr. Michael Thompson. What's going on, Michael?
Welcome, sir. Welcome.
All right.
Yeah, appreciate you being here to, you know, drop some knowledge on our audience. And for our live audience members, we invite you guys to jump in the chat room. Michael's going to be answering some questions pertaining to final expense and financial planning in general. So we would love your input on that as well. So we have a lot to talk about, guys, but we need to take a pause for the cause. So we're going to turn the microphone over to Wayne, who's going to talk to us about Manscaped.
All right. Give me just a second here. I'm trying to get my little logo up here. All right. Well, hey, while I'm trying to pull this thing up here, hey, I just want everyone to know we have we've been connected to a great sponsor, Manscaped. You've heard about it 3 or 4 times already. Manscaped is a product that is for the discriminating man who wants to be clean. So what we got here is we all receive packages that include a lawnmower. Yeah, that's the razor, shaver, all that bodily hair. We got, and a couple of us also got some additional products. Steph talked about it before. There's a weed whacker. That's to get the nose hairs, those ear hairs, and all those things. So they'll just be the JBAM. Scaped is the code you use for the 20% discount, JBAMscape at manscaped.com. And you get wonderful products that are waterproof, that are heavy duty, that have stood the test of time. Everyone who's used it has enjoyed it. There have been no problems yet. So I just want you to say, with all the products that come with it, they have some different moisturizing tools. Yes, I said moisturizing tools that will help keep things moist. And there's some smell goods, I think they call it too. So smell good. Yeah. So
effervescence.
Effervescence is all about man care. Man care and effervescence, as Mike said. So right. Hey, for the month of April, we have a special coupon code, which is JBAMscape. Use that at the time of checkout and you will get a 20% discount on any of your Manscaped products.
Plus free shipping.
Including free shipping. Thank you. So we'd like to thank Manscaped again for all that they've done and the quality of products. And we're glad to have them as our first sponsor.
All right,
Charles.
So Michael, you Manscaped?
I need that code.
All right. JBAMscape. We'll put it back out there. We'll put it out there.
All right. So, guys, it's crazy how many people are out here walking around. They do not have their financial houses in order. You know, folks are passing around the hat. They set up GoFundMe pages when folks pass away in their families. So Real talk, how prepared are you and your families for the inevitable? Let's talk about it.
Well, I'm not. I'll start. I'm not. And I'm I don't want to say I'm ashamed to say it, but I think I'm in the I don't even say the minority. I don't. Michael, you can correct me if I'm wrong. When I say we, our community, are we financially planning the way others do? Because that's something that was not necessarily passed on to me.
Mm-hmm. Right. Absolutely not, unfortunately. And one of the things that I found more and more is, and you'll see it, you know, one thing I want to mention is GoFundMe is not life insurance. So in essence, these types of mechanisms, and it's unfortunate because most people, especially our people, unfortunately, we have not been taught the financial concepts necessary to step ahead, to develop. And we see it more and more. So usually, when do most people, especially us, when do we find out that we're not together? We don't have it right. It's usually when it's too late.
Exactly, right. Yeah.
No doubt, right? No doubt.
And so that's when we're moving in that state of panic. And like Charles mentioned, that's when most people now, we have to kind of sit around the table and pass the hat. Yes. And it's unfortunate that it gets to that point, but it's a reality that unfortunately in our community especially, we are vastly underserved when it comes to financial matters and financial education.
So Michael, let me take a step back and allow you to properly introduce yourself and your company to our audience.
Sure thing. Well, I am Michael Thompson, and I have been in the financial services now 22 plus years. And started back in 1998 when I was 11 years old.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's right, right? I'm sticking to it. But it's been a journey, to say the least. And one of the things that has propelled me to not only stay in the industry, but to build upon it to where we're now in a position to where my company now, Game On Capital, as let me just say here, this is the first that I have even mentioned on a public platform, the new launch of the company Game On Capital. We've completely rebranded. We're in the position now of reaching a mass of people in a way that we've never seen before. And you heard it first on the Just Be a Man podcast.
So we got the exclusive. We got the exclusive. We got the exclusive, people.
Because that's what we do here. That's what we do here.
That's
where we're pioneers.
This is history. So I have spent the last 22 years definitely in a position to kind of reestablish the industry as we know it. Like I mentioned before, most of us, unfortunately, we know how to work very hard for money, but most people don't know how to make money work for them and certainly not pass it on the way it's supposed to. So I've spent the last 22 years learning, educating, helping individuals to basically just understand the concept of how money actually works, right? And so leading up to this point, my goal and our effort is to revolutionize the financial services industry and bridge that gap between the uneducated financially to now to a place to where we can actually move up in that economic standpoint in the world, to where we now can make moves that better our generations as opposed to the next generations falling backwards. Yeah, that's our goal.
Fantastic.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Real quick, in researching for the show tonight, here's some of the common things that I came across when talking about financial planning. Mm-hmm. I don't want to think about death. I don't need a will. My kids can figure it out. Mm-hmm. I'll be dead. Why should I care? Right. Estate planning has nothing to do with me because I'm not rich. Those are coming to some of this, the common threads that I came across. Can you speak to some of that?
Completely. Unfortunately, again, we're programmed definitely to think that way. And what happens is that, again, the next generation, I'm going to tell you a quick story, and this is kind of put it in perspective. I was sitting with a client, an older client. He was at retirement, 65, 66 years old. And he was holding a picture of him, his younger self, right, when he was in his 20s. And at the meeting, it was one of the most you know how those meetings or that moment to where like something happens to where it's just like, wow, what a perspective. Mm-hmm. He looked at that picture and he said to his younger self, he said, I want to thank this man for being disciplined and focused and wanting to find a way so that this man, the present day man, can live a comfortable life moving forward with his wife. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, he had just retired. Him and his wife had been working for 30 years. And he just said, for the last 6 to 8 months that we've been retired together, I'm literally just now starting to build a real relationship with my wife.
Wow.
I'm just now starting to know her.
Wow.
That's powerful.
So much time working. And so one of the things that he did, and this is what kind of put me in a different perspective, he sat down and while we were going through his financial process, he stopped me mid-sentence and he was just like, Mike, do you know your father? Which I thought was kind of weird. I mean, I know him, but I knew the guy, but I didn't know him that well for him to ask me a question that personal. But he was like, do you know your father? And under the circumstances, I told him, I said, no, I don't know my father. I've never met him, right? Don't know his name or anything, never met him. And he allowed me to proceed. Then he, 10 minutes later, asked me, do you know your grandfather? And so I was like, yeah, the one that I know, that's my man, that's my guy, you know, he's everything, right? 5 minutes later, we proceed, and I'm starting to get a bit frustrated. He said, do you know your great-grandfather? And I looked at him, I said, no, I don't know my great-grandfather. And he allowed me to proceed again. So he stopped me, I'm not kidding, about a minute and a half later and said, Mike, do you know your great-great-grandfather? I threw my pen down and I said, hey man, listen, I don't know where this is going, but can you ask me everything all at one time right now because you're kind of throwing me off. And he stopped me and he said, why don't you know your great-grandfather and your great-great-grandfather? Why don't you know him? And I said, well, they died 1,000 years before I was born. I have no idea who they are. Nobody ever talked about them much. And you know, I've never seen any pictures just because of that. And so he said, you know what, Mike? It's not that you don't know your great-grandfather or great-great-grandfather because no one talked about them, because nobody took a picture of them. He said, you don't know them because they didn't leave you anything.
Mm.
Mm.
And that made me stop.
Wow.
He said, if you talk to the youngest DuPont, if you talk to the youngest Walter, you talk to any of these wealthy families right now, talk to the youngest member of the family, they can tell you everything about their grandfather, great-grandfather, great-great-grandfather. And that perspective put me on a path to really understand that it's because we've been conditioned somehow because of the struggle, so to speak, to just take care of now, take care of us. I had to struggle, so guess what? My kids will have to struggle.
Mm-hmm.
Quite honestly, when I sit around people or I sit around clients that technically have that mindset, here's the reality, and it's unfortunate. That's not the people you can help, because if someone decides that I just want to be this way, it's not a whole lot you can do if you're willing to give them information and they don't want it, because there's nothing more powerful than a made-up mind.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. No doubt. Thank you for that.
I would just have to say to that point, Mike, I would never let history repeat itself. I've been through a situation with my family where my mother was semi-prepared, not fully. Mm-hmm. And I refuse to repeat history repeat itself. So I took what I experienced and added it to my repertoire. And I made sure that I did everything I could to ensure that my beneficiaries would have what they needed to continue once I'm gone. I'm not gonna leave that. The worst thing to do is leave that that situation in the hands of somebody who's not prepared.
Exactly.
You know, so I think people should open up conversation with your family. Those of you out there, Facebook, IG, I'm just telling you, open up the conversation. If they don't wanna talk about it, you know, talk to them little by little, write some stuff down, but have some type of plan written down from them. I know a lot of people don't wanna talk about death and dying, but it needs to happen because you don't want to be caught off guard, because it's a lonely existence. Because when that thing happens, you're so focused and doing so much things, and a lot, some people tend to want to help, but they don't really know how to.
Sure.
So I just have to say to everybody out there, just please try to be as prepared as you can. If you can't afford different services, there's things online you can learn about. There's a lot of information about funeral planning, estate planning, even talking to a financial advisor for free. Look into it, because that's what I had to do. I refused to go down that path and repeat the cycle that I experienced when my mom passed away. And I had to learn as I went, and I will never do that again. And that's all I want to say.
And Michael, yeah, we're going to want you to get into some specifics, but
definitely,
you know, you all know, I mean, you're my brothers, you know, a couple of weeks ago, my father actually had a pacemaker installed in his chest. And during that time, it was kind of surreal because I'm sitting around wondering, if the worst happens, I have no idea where my father even wants to be buried. I don't know what he wants me to do in terms of his funeral service. I don't know what he has in terms of insurance, you know, all of those things. So it taught me a valuable lesson. And you nailed it, Mike, when you said that we need to have those conversations. And so what I did from that point forward is I started having those conversations. I sent a mass message out to members of my family and say, look, if you don't want to tell me this information, it's cool, but somebody in the family needs to know what your will is as it relates to your death. Also, do you have life insurance? We need to know that. We need to know, you know, how to tap into those resources in the event that, you know, again, because we're all going down that path eventually. It's not even a matter of if we're going, it's just a matter of when. So we have to be prepared for it. And again, not only just for ourselves and our immediate family, but for those that are around us as well.
Right.
Completely. Well, Charles, I can definitely speak on that with certainty of the amount of situations that I've been in, seeing families that at the moment that something happens, the first thing that comes up, where's the insurance? Is there any insurance? If they didn't talk about it or think about it any time prior, at that moment, the first thing they start looking for is the insurance. Cool. And you mentioned something so powerful, because planning is everything. Most people don't have either enough insurance, or they don't have insurance, period, or they don't have the right kind of insurance, because again, the industry has not taught us what's specific for us. As a matter of fact, most people I talk to, they say, well, I got some insurance on my job.
Right.
You know, my job, I have, you know, a few times my salary on my job, right? But guess what? When the job is out or over, guess what happens to that insurance? It's over too. Right. And then most people think, well, you know, it's too expensive. It's really too expensive. I don't want to pay for that. And I've gone into homes to where literally I've seen 4,000 channels of cable, but nothing set aside for the family. And I look at it like, look at this. Our cell phones. Most people have a cell phone in their hands. Right. Fully insured. When you drive your car, it's by law, you're supposed to have insurance.
That's right.
Your home, insurance, everything. We are a very insurance intensive country, but the most valuable asset that we have that we can offer to ourselves and our family is insurance on our life. And while everything else around us, usually, you even have appliances in your house right now that have insurance on it, right? But the most valuable asset that we have, which is our life, to pass down, most of the time, that's the one thing that is very little insured, or it is not insured at all, most valuable. So steps to take in that is, number one, you have to know how much insurance is right for you. Sometimes two or three times just on your job is not enough.
No.
What's right for you? We have to identify what that is, right? And then, specific to your goal and objectives, we also have to know what's the right type of insurance that's out there available that's specific to your situation. You can't just pick a random number. And I've seen people, why did you pick that amount of insurance that you have? A lot of times I hear, well, it's a nice round number. It makes sense, right? But guess when people find out it's not enough. So what we want to do is a few things. The first thing you have to do is care. The second thing you have to do is you have to be established to know what's right for you and the right type of insurance that's right for you, because most of the time we don't have, and I think it was Chuck that mentioned, we talk about an estate, right? That word estate, I'm the same way. When I was younger, I thought the word estate meant for rich people, right. Only wealthy people. But what I found out is everybody has an estate, right? When you pass away, guess what? Whatever you have that you own straight out, that goes into a pot and the government will assess. That's this process that you call probate. They will assess what your value is, right? And from there, that's exactly right, Mike. And guess what?
Terrible.
They get to now decide what your taxes, not for you, but for your family, what the taxes are going to be on that. Do you know when that bill is due? Anything over $1 million right now, and they may have tweaked it a bit, but anything over $1 million in an estate is taxable up to 55%. 55%. That's left to whoever it is that's next in line for you. That's left, and that bill is due in 90 days. Has anybody ever seen an estate sale?
Yes.
Yep. Absolutely. All the time. All the time.
They're for? They're for people to sell assets so that they can have money to pay the tax bill. Otherwise, guess who's going to come and take assets? Government is going to come and take assets.
Uncle Sam. Right. Yes, sir.
Uncle Sam. Yeah. He's coming. He's coming.
Well, that was actually one of my questions between a trust and a will. Yeah. And which one you recommend? In doing my research, I was thinking about going the way of the trust. First, can you explain the two, which one you think would be more beneficial?
Exactly. The easiest way to explain it and to obtain it is everybody needs a will because that's directions. That's specific to where you want, how you want things to be executed. The trust is the ownership specifically of the will. That's the umbrella, right? Inside of the trust, if it's set up properly, there are different kinds of trusts, but if it's set up properly, the trust can help to negate some of the tax consequences that goes with, you know, not being properly protected with your estate. So the trust is technically the umbrella, and the will is the directions of how you want your funds or whatever your assets are to be distributed. It's your directions. And that actually is, you know, there's something called a living will too. That's actually when you're alive, because I want people to think about this. Suppose you're not able to talk right now. Suppose something happens and you can't talk. Mm-hmm. Who's in place to take care or to execute? Do you know that there are websites now? You ever heard of unclaimed funds?
Yeah. Yep.
Yep. You know what that stuff is? That's because there are beneficiaries that can't be found. When people pass away, there are issues financially. People don't know where accounts are. When people pass away, you don't know account numbers, don't know accounts exist, all of those things. And those funds are just held up, right? So that's a reality.
Right. Hey, Mike, I got a question. Now, what say, Seth, for instance, now, how do you ensure the proper person gets the right amount of compensation or assets? Just say if you got a younger brother, is taking care of the mom and pops, and the older brother says, I don't care, or he's estranged, don't come around, whatever. And then at the time of the funeral, he shows up to looking for his, you know, got his hand out after you done took care of everybody and to clear the house, the car, make sure they went to their appointments, everything else.
Sure.
How do you ensure that person gets their just deserved, like, what they versus, because I know the oldest and then the one after the oldest gets it and whatever. How does a parent say, hey, this younger guy has been taking care of me, I want to make sure that he's taken care of, versus when the older brother shows up? How do you differentiate that?
That's a great question. That is the sole purpose of a will. And that's why anybody could be appointed. I don't have to use the next in line. I can use who I think is the most responsible. You follow me? So in this space, think about this. It doesn't matter what I intend. It doesn't matter what I hope for. It doesn't matter what I believe to happen in my family. When I pass away, all that matters is what is written. That's it. If it's not written, courts decide everything. And if it's not written, the family trouble, the family fighting, and who feels entitled, that's where that entitlement comes in at. Who feels entitled? And guess what? That's where the family discord probably shows its head the most, is when they feel there's something to put their hands on. Unfortunately. Bruh,
let me tell you, my wife's aunt showed up at the funeral and she pulled a gun out on somebody at the funeral, bro. Wow. Okay, you know, because of some nonsense that was going on in the family surrounding, you know, exactly what you're talking about. Yeah. You know, the will of the, you know, aspired person, you know, with regards to how things should go. You know, this person had some information that other people didn't have. It wasn't in writing. So it caused havoc, you know, within the family. But I do have a question along those lines. But keep in mind, you know, Howard Hughes, Prince, Michael Jackson, comedian Robin Harris, Sonny Bono, Howard Hughes, I mean, Jimi Hendrix, Bob Marley, all these people died without a legitimate will in place. So we're not only talking about Joe Blow government worker, you know, we're talking about some affluent people out here that don't have things in place. And of course, it causes problems. So let's talk about those problems in terms of what are the consequences of dying without a will, dying without life insurance, things of that nature. What have you seen?
I've seen two things. Number one, the worst of family discord is usually when someone passes away and there are things that need to be divvied up or can be touched upon. This is when you see the worst of it. And sometimes it can come out of nowhere. And this sense of entitlement could create so much drama. And hey, Charles, you went to the next level. They bringing guns to funerals.
Oh yeah, yes, sir.
That's real. But imagine that. Imagine mourning someone's loss, but at the same time, the ones that are still alive, their goal is to fight for what they feel they're entitled to. So number one, family discourse. I've seen families that still to this day, the relative died years ago, and the families still don't speak to each other. Yeah. Separation, division, right? And then at the same time, if there's nothing written, if there's nothing in place, will, trust, whatever, or even healthcare directives, I literally have seen states come in and do all of the planning for you, and they do it in the exact opposite that anybody in the family would want. So in that regard, I've seen funds held up in probate, in court, and all kinds of things to where assets that are necessary. Can you imagine having a house that you're supposed to have access to and you cannot because it is tied up in the court still? What happens with that? People still have to live.
Yeah, so Mike, there's a lot of good information here. And I one thing I would say, I think one of the questions early on is if the members of us are prepared for death or estate or whatever. And one thing I can say is that I am definitely worth a lot more dead than alive. But
are we all?
But
you're right about that, brother.
But what I want to say though is, you know, so I know we got bunches of people watching, and some of the things that Chuck mentioned before, people think they don't have enough money or whatever, whatever. Mm-hmm. Could you just kind of touch on, like, realistically, for someone who has a, I don't know what you call a regular job or whatever, what's a minimum of
the basic
life insurance? Like, what could they spend in a month? Because we know what they spend on a, they spend $100 on a cell phone. You know, even if you got a track phone. You know,
More than that.
So, you know, could just like, let's put it in perspective. What could it cost?
Sure thing. Well, here's what I'd suggest. This is a simple formula that I've used, and I, you know, depending on the situation, but a basic rule of thumb. This is not etched in stone. Every situation is different, but this is a basic rule of thumb. I use a method called the DIME method, D-I-M-E, okay? To establish what should be the right face amount or somewhere in the area of the right face amount of insurance. Okay, that's number one. The DIME method is very simple. The D stands for debt. So at the point of discussion, whatever your debt is, minus the house, we're talking about credit card debt, car loan, whatever that debt should be added up. Number one, that has to go into the equation when adding up what amount of insurance is right for you. That's number one, okay? Number two, here's the biggest thing. Income, that's the I, income replacement. Because right now, here's the reality. Most family, husband and wife, typically 100% of the income goes to take care of 100% of the bills. Is that right? Now in today's society, husband and wife usually work, right? To take care of everything. But what happens if 50% of the income is gone? Does 50% of the bills disappear?
Nope.
So now 50% of the income is here to try to support 100% of the bills. So even though we can't bring the life back, what we can do is we can replace the income. And that's what the I stands for. So literally, if you were to take 7 to 10 times the income, what we've statistically seen is that a family literally takes about 10 years financially to recover from the loss of a breadwinner. So what we want to do is, if in the equation, right, and if it fits, of course, we want to go 7 to 10 years of the income for income replacement. Does that make sense so far?
Yep.
Absolutely.
The M in this stands for mortgage. So what's the balance? The biggest expense that most people have, or the biggest debt that most people have, is the mortgage.
Yeah.
So that M, whatever at the time of conversation, whatever that mortgage balance is, that should be covered in the totality of your face amount of insurance. And lastly, if the situation fits, you know, I want my kids to go to college. I want to have, we mentioned it earlier, I want my kids to be able to have access to funds to be able to go to college. If they get a scholarship, God bless them. But at least my portion, they will be able to go to college financially if something happens to me. So that E stands for education. And right now, on an average, the average 4-year degree right now is roughly about $100,000. That's just tuition. That doesn't include room and board and whatever's going on out here. That's just tuition. Now, if they want to go private school, how about this? Average right now is $150,000 to $200,000 for private school. That's the Ivy League deals, right? So if you were to take those numbers and add them together, that technically is where we start as a face amount of insurance that's right for the family. Now, some people look at that and be like, oh my gosh, it's astronomical. Well, it actually isn't, because if you're sitting there, and typically when I'm sitting with a client, if I can reach it, I'll turn the lights off. And I'll say, at this moment, it's all done for the husband or for the wife. And I'll turn the lights back on and I'll say, at this moment, what would be taken care of, or what would you lose if this place is not protected completely? This place in your life was not protected. And most of the time, how much insurance do you have right now? Oh, you only have 2 times your income? You only have 3 times your income on your job? Good luck with getting the house taken care of. Wouldn't you want the house paid for if something happened to the breadwinner? Wouldn't you want debts paid? Because here's what I found out. I found out that bill collectors don't care if the person that has the debt dies. And if you're married, guess what? The debt doesn't disappear. And some people think that. They think the debt disappears. No, it does not. It gets transferred. They're still coming for you.
Right. Yeah.
That's the basic. So now, once it gets to the point of, I know what I need, the next question is, what does it cost? How can I afford this? And that's when the planning part comes into where we need to make space to afford the right amount of insurance.
And I want to say something really quick. I know Steph had some, but I was just going to say, you know, what about a person, and I'm not trying to point out anybody, but what about a person who doesn't have the mortgage, doesn't have the big income, the single person, you know what I mean? Like, gotcha. Someone just make a, yeah, you know, live in an apartment living, got a couple bucks, sure, you know, man, but got a job, but maybe they got some kids and yeah, maybe they're single with the kids. You know, so your calculation is for, like, I don't know, kind of a perfect family situation. But sure, there's a lot of us that don't have that.
Understood.
So I'm just saying, I think that they should not feel left out. Like, they can't, like, they just ass out because they single.
That's right.
And renting. So
yes.
I'm sorry, I just wanted to bring that up to add on to.
No, that actually is a great point. And I have quite a few clients that are like that. And the question I ask is, how much do you believe your life is worth? Is it worth anything? You work. You have something to offer. You have something to leave. And so in a lot of cases, I'm figuring, do you plan to stay single forever? Do you plan to not have kids forever? Because one thing about insurance, okay, there are types of life insurance, and most people, here's the big misconception, is most people believe that life insurance is only valuable at death, which is not true. There are absolute, very powerful living benefits in the right type of life insurance that you could utilize while you're alive that give you access to some of the most unbelievable tax advantages known to man in life insurance. And the reason we don't know about them is because the wealthy has been using it forever. and we don't know. So even people who are single, even people who don't have kids yet, are you okay with not paying taxes on money as you build it? I have a way, and it's through life insurance.
Well, so I know Steph had a question. So Steph, want to jump in?
Yeah, absolutely. First yes, of all, this is like Bible study at First Baptist Church of Glen Arden. I mean, I'm writing notes like crazy. You know,
I didn't give a scripture yet. I got some, though.
All right, so I'm going to go back to your dime principle. Debt, income to live 7 to 10 years, mortgage, and education.
Sure.
So let's say I get a life insurance policy of $500,000. Maybe that'll cover, or even $1 million. All right, maybe that'll cover it. I pass away. Mm-hmm. How soon could my wife access it? Because, all right, you're going to bury me within 5 to 7 days. So that's a bill right there. My mortgage is coming up in 30 days.
That's right.
You know, and education, I got kids in school, you know, as well as I got Visa credit cards at the Yin Yang. They're still going to come. How soon could I access that from the insurance company? Because that's always been a fear of mine. How long is it going to take, or they're going to run me through the mill?
Mm-hmm. Very good question. As a matter of fact, that's why it's important to know the protocol of the company that you purchase your life insurance from, right? And so in that regard, on an average, it's usually between 30 and I've seen it as far as 90 days, all things being equal. Now, if the death was suspect, it could take longer because of, you know, investigation process, but typically it's 30 to 90 days, depending on the company that you use. However, there are specific types of life insurance that give what's called funeral expense that's specifically for that. Mm-hmm. So I have a company that I know very well that we do business with, that they're paying the death benefit payout is within 48 hours.
Wow.
All you have to show is proof of death. With a death certificate, and they do everything for you. The funeral is planned. The directives are already done. So literally a client just responded to me. I went to church a couple of weeks ago, and this client stopped me and just said, Mike, I just want to thank you because my mom passed away a year ago. And for whatever reason, I didn't even know. Mom passed a year ago. And they said that this protection that you set up, we have never, ever, in any death history that we've ever experienced in our family, it's never been this smooth. Everything about the funeral was already planned. The company actually called the funeral home, had everything executed that they said, and we had a check within 48 hours. So it depends on the company and the service of the company.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that. Also, you know, I've got parents that are 78 and 79, and I know they have a trust and as well as will. Of course, I don't have access to it because it's going to be after.
Sure.
But how do I follow? I guess I need to have a discussion with them. Do you have life insurance and can you give me the policy? Because I'm not going to have time to dig through your safe to That's get right. that information. So I guess it's imperative or important for us to talk, have that hard discussion with our parents and say, at least give me your life insurance policy.
It's absolutely imperative that you do that. And that's a great point because like you said, Charles, is that this conversation has to be had.
Yeah.
Because it's going to be had anyway. It's just, are you going to be prepared for it? It's coming. This conversation is coming. It's just, are you prepared? So you need to know, in a best case scenario, you need to know the life insurances, where they are. You need to know whoever the executor will be, whoever the one that is the appointed one, which you should have that. You should know where accounts are, whatever type of investments they have or whatever kind of savings checking, wherever money is, someone should have access to it. Not necessarily access to reach in and pull something out of the account, but just know where things are.
Yeah.
So that when this happens, now you will have access, but you should know where things are. And these things literally could be written or they can all be digitized to where when it happens, it can be in a very secure military grade digital vault where all this information can be stored. And when it's time to execute, this is where the appointed person can have access to execute what the final wishes are of the deceased.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Mike.
No, I was going to say real quick, I know a lot of people think it has to be business It doesn't have to be. It can be somewhere over breakfast, over lunch, brunch.
Sure.
I mean, walk in the park, sit down at the bench, at the table, have a little sandwich, a little something to drink. I mean, absolutely. Just talk about it, write it down. Don't make it seem so tight and technical because a lot of our elders are so tight. They don't want to tell their business. What I said, listen, we need to know now. I don't want to have to start digging through this stuff, your room and trying to find your secret spot that you had.
Exactly.
I'm telling you, that's the worst thing ever. You know, having to go through somebody's bedroom or something like you, a detective or police doing investigation. So please, anybody out there listening, talk to your people, you know, who you can trust or whatever, and let them know where things are and put it in a safe place. So just in case something happens, you people know, just opening up the conversation is very important. Is just what I want to say, buddy.
Yeah, that's a good word, Michael.
Very true.
Good word. So, Michael, I know you, I think you had something prepared to share.
Yeah,
as far as maybe some slide things of that nature. So,
I do.
Hold on one second, Charles. Before we go into that, you know, we're approaching about 40 minutes in into the show. And I just would like for, if depending on people's time, I'd like for Mike to kind of just give his little spiel and promotion on his items before he moves into, I guess, what we call the next phase, which you were just discussing, Mike, Charles.
Well, I appreciate that. As a matter of fact, I believe one of the purposes that at least I want to leave, here's a part of my legacy, is leaving education, knowledge. Because now, once you get the knowledge, right, you can never say, I didn't know. Nobody told me. Now you have access to it. So one of the things that I have and I put together, and literally this is 20 years of experience, I've created a workshop. A complete 4-series workshop where you can follow along. And all of these questions, everything that we're talking about now and more, I say from the womb to the tomb, everything. I put specific workbook where you can follow along and you can fill in this information as we're going, either live action where you have the hard copy of things, or it's all digital to where you can play it and listen at your own leisure, and you can fill in the workbook as you go along. And so this series, and let me click on it really quick, if you don't mind. Can I share my screen?
Absolutely.
Yes, please.
All right, share screen. Let me make sure I'm sharing the right thing. Okay.
You're going to put that picture of Neil Long up?
Oh, man. I made sure I erased all that stuff before I got on here. So here's the workshop. It's called the 4 Financial Building Blocks. Can everybody see that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
4 Financial Building Blocks that will set you up for life series. We spent time, effort, energy to answer all of these questions and go into detail. You will know in this how much insurance is right for you. You will know what type of insurance, because I do the breakdown, so you understand the different insurances that are available out there and how it can be specific pertaining to your direct situation, you and your family. I have estate planning in that as well, where you'll understand about healthcare directives. You'll understand about trust and wills and specific things and how to word these things. Everything that goes along with saving and building wealth while you're alive, the living benefits of life insurance and other vehicles that allow you to maximize your earning potential and understand how these wealthy people have been building their wealth and transferring their wealth for generations. I put it all in there. As a matter of fact, I have some contemporaries who literally said there's no way you would give this information away at the price point that you're giving it away. Because trust me when I tell you, if you call any of the major brand companies out there right this second, try it after we're done or tomorrow, call the main companies that are marketed out there, Merrill Lynch, Payne Wibber, Dean Witter, Charles Schwab, name them, and ask them to sit down with you and do a financial analysis or educate you on this stuff and ask them how much they charge for them. Mm-hmm. Most people don't have access to it because the industry is not designed to support the average and ordinary. It's designed to support the top 1%. So I've taken the information and I've placed it in this workshop to where literally at the end of this workshop, this series, you will know more than 95% of most people when it comes to financial issues and how specifically it pertains to your family. So, and you directly. So this will go to market And the price point that has already been established, the price point for this will be $1,000 for this course, $1,000. That didn't sit well with me in the preparation of this. So what I decided to do was, I decided to now bring the price point down, even to lose money. When I publicly launch this, we're bringing the price point down to $297 for this entire series here. $1,000 deal. But we're bringing it down. When we launch it officially within about 30 days, that price point, $297. But for everybody that's on this line tonight, I am going to give it to you completely free. No all cost, right. No strings attached.
Right. Wow. Wow.
Thank you, brother. Right. Thank you.
That's you appreciate
right. You. Just for this JBAM audience. So all you have to do is go on to Blocks, BLOCKS.GameOnCapital.com. And what you will do, you'll see this image here. And all you do is go down to where it says, get it now. You click onto that. And all you have to do is put in your name and your email address. We will capture that. And for this audience, we will recognize to send you when it's available. Before it goes public, we're going to send you access to where you can digitally have access to it at your leisure. And we'll send it in your email that you put into this. So for the JBAM audience exclusive, you'll be the first to have it, and it will cost you absolutely nothing.
Look at that. All right.
All right. Look at that.
That's all right.
All right.
Incredibly generous, sir.
We do big things here. We do it first.
I hope them folks are paying attention. I hope they showed up. Because if they showed up.
Hey, yeah. Let me tell you this, just so you know. We've done a test with pre-orders of this thing, a test of it. And believe me, it is something, I can't say I didn't expect it. If I could tap my own self on the shoulder, I can't say I didn't expect it, but the response is absolutely overwhelming in a great way, because this information is so powerful. And this is at the $300, $297 price point.
Michael, is this time stamp? Because again, this video is going to be out there for a minute. So how do you control, you know, when people can take advantage of the free offer and, you know, when do you cut it off?
So here's what I'll do right now. The database, if you put your email in right now, because this is not public yet. So please don't share it. Anybody that's watching this, don't share it with other people yet. It's not public yet. This is specific and exclusive for the JBAM audience. So literally any emails that's captured tonight, I know it came through here because it's not public yet. So yes, that will be stamped there.
Don't hate, participate.
What's that?
I told them to don't hate, participate.
Participate, there it is,
man. Right. Mr. Thompson, appreciate
that's
you.
That's how I will know that it is from you, this man. Audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, I just ordered mine. I just wanted to point that out. I went to another screen and ordered it.
Oh, you want it.
They're splitting screens.
It tells me that we will send you an email to create your username and password so that you can access the course material. Keep an eye on your email. Don't forget to spam.
That's the forward in real time.
Yeah.
That is real time. So
that's
it's
real,
in
that's
there. And Mike,
yes, sir.
I was going to say, with that information, if somebody purchases this, not only can they share it with their kids can share it. I know things change, but I mean, that's a form of generational wealth where they're learning as they go, as they grow.
Absolutely.
That is exactly right. That's what this that's awesome. Is. I tell that's people awesome, often, man. This is the thing that I'm going to leave the earth with. So in this regard, that goal is to get it in the hands of the generations that have it now. And once you have this information, you can't go back. You can't say, I didn't know. This is now where this can be transferred to the next generation.
Real quick, Michael, we've got some folks online that are saying they want the information or the address again. Can you shout that out again?
Absolutely. It is Blocks, BLOCKS dot GameOnCapital.com.
And one of the viewers, CJ Britt, actually posted the link.
Oh, nice.
It's in the comments, and you'll see the picture.
Thank you. I was just doing that, so thanks. Uh-huh.
Just for this audience, so get it, because this will launch officially in the next 30 to 45 days to the public. And we've got a major marketing plan in place right now to where it's going to do what it does. I'm telling you. So everybody here,
get awesome. It.
That's hot.
Awesome.
That's hot.
That's yeah. right. That, I like that. You know,
hey, Charles,
you're just you. Be a man audience is good.
That's
you
exactly
might just
right.
be out of luck if you're not. So for y'all,
hey, Charles, you want to go ahead and do that break now?
The break?
Yeah. Before we run out of time and we go to part two.
Wayne, why don't you cover the break, sir?
I thought we were just gonna keep going. I thought we'd just make the break as we needed it. I just wanted to make sure that he got his ad in the first section.
And well, so how much more time do you have, Michael?
Oh man, I could go all night.
well, I do know Michael had more stuff he wanted to show, mm-hmm. and so I just wanted to make sure before we got to that first hour, he got to put that promo in, and so there was no set break. We're just gonna, we're gonna use a clock to determine.
All right, real quick. For the folks that we have online here, first of all, Michael, you got another order, sir. So I just want to make sure that you understand that.
Nice.
The folks are watching and listening and they're supporting. That's number one.
Wonderful.
Number two, because we've got some other folks that have just jumped in, a real quick, real brief recap, and then we'll go into whatever the next segment is you guys want to go into. But I just want to make sure everybody gets the benefit of what you're telling them, Michael.
Perfect.
Real quick, just tell them about your package real quick. And I see up here, CJ Britt, I want to thank you if you're still online here. He puts your address out there again, which is blocks, BLOCKS dot game on capital.com. Let me say that again. It's blocks, BLOCKS dot game on capital.com. All right, so that's the address. You guys can go there and get all the information. And we're talking about financial planning, and we've got our guest today, Michael Thompson, and he's killing it, y'all. There we go.
I appreciate
back
that.
To you. Good stuff, Chuck.
So once again, first of all, I appreciate this opportunity. And secondly, I wanted to make sure that this audience specifically has something tangible that you can put your hands on, you could grab, you could use, and literally it is the educational the foundation of building a secure financial future. The information that's in this package, this course, right? And let me share the screen again so you can see. But the information that's in here is information that the financial industry, they charge many thousands of dollars for what is included in this package. So was just shared by Chuck, blocks.gameoncapital.com. For this audience only, the JBAM audience only, I am going to give away my four building blocks that will set you up for life series course that is awesome. Interactive, step-by-step, everything that you need from wherever you are in your financial life right now, wherever you are moving forward to not only build a future for yourself, but also being able to pass that to the next generation. And you will understand exactly how the wealthy, the top one percenters, how they've been doing it for generations. It is all in here. And again, my contemporaries literally have no concept of how in the world I could let this go for the price point that I'm letting this go. But I tell you what, I want to make a difference, not just a sale. So the reality is in this offer for this audience today is something that I believe from a value standpoint is something that you won't find anywhere else in the industry, certainly not at this price point.
I appreciate it, Mike. And I just want to let the people know out there, I'm an original JBAM member, and Mike is one of our honorary members. And I'm going to tell you, he's been the same type of brother, the way he's enlightening us and giving us information. He's been that way from day one.
That's right.
I can swear my right hand to it. He's always been real with us, and we're going to keep it real with y'all. Listen, don't miss out on this opportunity for generational wealth and everything else. So please do what you can. I support this brother because, like I said, he's never changed. You know,
I appreciate
it. So let's do it, people. Let's support this young man. All right.
Thank you.
And for those of you that missed out on J-Man, you're just going to be out of luck.
All right, well, guys, we have a unique opportunity here. We have our financial expert, Michael Thompson, in the house. So we're going to take a little bit more time to just, kick it with you. Just throw the questions out there, fellas. We can talk to him about anything.
I got a question for Mike.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, hey, Mike, yes, I know we're in this digital era, digital assets, credit cards, social media stuff, mm-hmm. Electronic records, so photos, financial accounts.
Yeah.
those things. For people who are not privy to that type of stuff, or who don't know, because I, as myself, I'm not one of those, you know, IT guys. I got these guys here to help me out whenever I have a question. Are those things important when people pass away? How is important that people know how to access this stuff?
I think it's the ultimate of importance, simply because without the information, you don't know what direction to go in. It's like a compass or a GPS. When someone passes away, or this information, you know, obviously is pertinent to, I guess, the transfer of wealth or access. If you don't have it and there's no access to it, literally it just stays tied up. And while things are tied up, guess what's happening with the living? They're fighting in most cases. Yep. Yeah. They're fighting. So it's imperative that it's clear where these where the access is to everything pertaining to the recently deceased. Everything.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's important, too, with this whole thing, that people are prepared the best they can be, because you don't need to be fighting. I'm going to tell you now, when you're grieving and being angry at the same time, it will totally wipe you out. It will take your sap your energy. Please. Completely. So I'm saying, if you're watching, like I said, grab the program and get your stuff in order with your family and yourself, because you do not want to be fighting and grieving at the same time. That is one of the worst things, worst feelings ever. And that's from a personal opinion.
Yeah. Now you touched on it a couple of times, Michael. How do rich people use life insurance? You talked about, you know, living benefits and things of that nature. How do people get rich off of this stuff?
Okay. Now, you really opened a can of worms right there, Mr. Charles.
We like worms. We like worms.
This is one of my favorite subjects, because I could not believe it when I saw it. You always wonder what they, just like you say, you always wonder what the heck do these people do to not just be at the level they are, but how come each generation gets better? It gets stronger. But what we're used to is, to a degree, kind of regressing a bit. What is the separator right there? But what you will realize is there are tax codes that are specifically designed for life insurance. Let me get you a brief bit of history on that. See, what I talked about before is, number one, the way that this is formulated is wealthy people are all, what's the biggest issue that we face with our money?
Taxes.
So the more money you have, what's the biggest issue?
The more taxes you pay.
It is taxes. So with life insurance, aside from any other vehicle out there, and I know people have 401ks, TSPs, IRAs, savings account, mutual fund stocks, whatever, which are good vehicles based on what you're using them for, if you know how to use them. But the greatest leverage on earth and all of the biggest tax advantages, they're all resting in life insurance. So wealthy people know that. And so there are laws, specific codes, tax codes. I'll give them to you. As a matter of fact, in the course, I give you the tax codes where this stuff is.
Say it again.
Oh, we got the cheat codes.
Stop talking dirty to me.
The cheat codes are in there, I'm telling you. So what happens is that, of course, when they know what the avenues are, they purchase giant life insurance policies. I'm talking about many millions of dollars face amount life insurance. And what the government says, what the codes say, is that whatever assets is in the life insurance, cash, live cash that you can fund, do you know that there's a type of life insurance out here that allows you to literally fund it, grow money, not pay taxes as the money grows? Yep. There's a loophole in there to where you could use the money, withdraw the money in the way that the account allows you to do. And do you know you can actually not pay taxes on the use, the withdrawal of the money? And so when you use the money, do you know that the cash value inside the policy, cash value does not decrease as you take money out? So when you take money out of your 401k, IRA, even regular bank account, whatever, the value of your account is going to go down by the amount that you withdrew, right? And in most cases, there's going to be a tax consequence when you take out of your 401k, IRA, TSP, 403b, whatever you have. There's a tax consequence. And if you're not 59 and a half yet, guess what else there is? there's a 10% early withdrawal penalty.
Yeah.
And did you also know that literally when you fund these things, these vehicles that we're familiar with, the vehicles that we were kind of infiltrated with when we started working, do you know that if you keep money in there too long, there's a 50% penalty if you don't withdraw it at a certain period, a 50% penalty.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
On top of taxes. Mm-hmm. But with life insurance, those laws, those codes are not the same. So guess what? Do you think wealthy people fund 401ks to the fullest? No. Do they fund? Guess what they fund? They fund life insurance, because inside of life insurance, because of that umbrella of life insurance, the cash that's growing inside of that, do you know that that money cannot be seized in any civil litigation? You cannot even be sued for it. I'll give you an example. Here's one real quick.
I'll take it.
Here's an example. Do y'all remember O.J. Simpson?
Mm-hmm. Who?
Here's a prime example. O.J. Simpson, the football player.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I'm just messing with you.
I want y'all to pay attention to this part because it will bring it to light. You realize that he won the criminal case, right?
Mm-hmm.
He got off.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But he lost the civil case. Do you remember that?
Correct. Oh, yeah.
He owed the Goldmans something like $35 million.
Right. Mm-hmm. Still does. Right.
Still does. Mm-hmm. Watch this. One of his lawyers was smart enough to set him up with one of these accounts. Guess what he did? You remember, even he lost the civil case and was in all that debt. Like you said, that was over 20 years ago. He still owes them.
Mm-hmm.
You see OJ? You see him still driving Bentley?
Ooh, on the golf course.
Golf course.
Yes, sir.
How does that happen when you owe somebody that kind of money? Think about this for a minute. This is how the wealthy do it. One of his lawyers was smart enough to help him to set up one of these types of accounts that I'm talking about right here and loaded it with about $4 to $5 million of cash money before this case closed. And literally what he has done. Now, you know, if he put any money into a regular savings checking account or retirement, whatever, you know, they will have access to it. The gold.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Here's what he did. Because of the way this thing is structured, he literally withdrew through the structure of how to do it. He withdrew $25,000 a month, mm-hmm, his living expenses, and put that on a Visa card. And so all of his green fees, car payment, home payment, wherever he lived, whatever that was, those expenses were coming off of a card that was connected to this account. So literally, because of the laws.
I tell you.
So bankruptcy, divorce, whatever, they can take everything else, but they cannot touch the funds that are inside this account.
Take divorce.
Now, is there a specific insurance? Is there what specific is it a specific insurance that we have to get?
It is.
We have to obtain.
It's a specific insurance with specific tax codes to it. Now, there are multiple types of insurance that include these codes. However, that's when you sit down with a professional like myself.
Somebody like you. You mean somebody like you?
Somebody somewhat like me.
Right.
Okay.
Somewhat like me that actually show you and help you to construct a plan. Now, you don't have to be wealthy to have this. You don't have to be wealthy. There's no qualification. There's no credit check. There's no background check for it. The only thing that is needed is a health check because it is life insurance first.
Right.
It's the protocols of life insurance. Go ahead.
So I just want to say something real quick, because this is kind of what we do in our community. It drives me absolutely insane. So bear with me for a second.
You got it.
We will go out and we will spend money on hair, nails. We will spend money on the flyest new outfit. We will spend money on all these things that depreciate in value that we can't keep, maintain, whatever. But we won't spend the minuscule amount of money to pay a professional to manage your assets and to help you navigate, you know, your finances in this thing called life. Yeah. I am a semi-retired entrepreneur. All right. And I was hard-headed. I thought early on I could do everything myself. Well, I did pretty good, but what I learned very quickly is there are professionals in place for a reason. So okay. as I sit here and I listen, I've heard a lot of this stuff before, but okay. you know, it was kind of over my head, and I didn't want to invest the money to pay a professional to help me through this. And what I'm saying, maybe listening or watching right now, do yourself a favor. Invest in yourself.
For sure.
And when I say invest in yourself, I'm not talking about going to get your nails done and new clothes, stuff like that. Right. I'm saying invest in a professional to help you with your finances, to help you get to the next level. Not necessarily just for yourself,
sure.
but for like what Michael is talking to us about, your family planning down the line. So that's my contribution to this, you know, as the entrepreneur dude that has had to go through this stuff, you know, I'm telling you, life is a lot more simple when you get out of your own way.
For sure.
And you invest, you take that little bit of investment, invest in yourself with a professional that can help take you to the next level. We don't know everything, but there are people out here that have gone to school and have the knowledge to help get you there. And Michael is here to help, you know, facilitate that. And I just want to piggyback on that and tell everybody, please invest in yourself. Get yourself a financial planner, a professional. And if you don't take anything away from this program, take Michael's course.
For sure.
That's
powerful. I just want to say with that, Chuck, and believe me, that is a very real issue, very real concern, because the main difference between the wealthy and not so much is wealthy know the difference between an asset and a liability.
Mm-hmm.
And they purchase assets. Exactly. We purchase liabilities.
Right.
And we believe that they're assets. Yeah. Right. So the end result to that is you have to know the difference. And when you talk about investing in yourself, it's so powerful, because where are you spending? Because we're going to spend it anyway. You know, we're the number one consumers out there, right? As far as dollars spent. So we're going to spend it somewhere, but invest in yourself. Right. And so here's the reality too. I wanted to tackle just that issue, that most people look at the financial professionals, and for whatever reason, and I get it, I understand, you got to be careful. You have to be, you know, clear on who you're dealing with, because in the financial business, just like any other industry, there's some jokers out there. And I've gone in and I've had to reconstruct what was constructed first before I even could start talking about their financial future, right? Because there's a trust issue. What's the most valuable thing that you have your emotions connected to? I mean, among other things, but it's your money. It's tight.
Yeah.
So trust is everything.
Yep.
It's everything. And
I can definitely vouch for Mr. Thompson. And he can tell you himself, man, I've vetted this dude for over a year before I started doing business with them. I'm talking multiple conference calls, met with this brother in person. I even pulled my father on a conference call with him for a couple of hours.
Oh, Pop, you brought Pops in. Pops
going to vet you. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I mean, we were just going through everything, because I wanted to know every nook and cranny, you know, in terms of, you know, how my money was being invested, how it was going to be utilized. And let me tell you, this brother's the real deal. I've been just nothing but just extremely happy with what he's done for me and my family. So I recommend him to anybody. And Michael, just, you know, share with the audience, man, how can folks get a hold of you?
Yeah, man.
So we have established now a pathway to technically get a hold of me. And also my team, because certainly I cannot do it all myself, and I can certainly not take credit for all of the things that we have launching soon. However, you can get a hold of me, michael@gameoncapital.com. Okay? michael@gameoncapital.com. And also, I know people have specific situations. They have specific questions maybe that they won't air here, but if you wanted to reach out to me in a direct manner, I could schedule an appointment with myself or someone like me as far as knowledge, right? Because I have a very strong team also that you can go on to, and you can go to, oh goodness, where do you go to get me? You can go to gameoncapital.com. to schedule an appointment. There's an appointment scheduler on that pathway to where all you have to, there's a video, about a 15-minute video. You get a chance to know a little bit more, understanding a little bit more about what I'm doing. And then at the end of it, it allows you to schedule an appointment and we can set it up and I can answer questions specifically. And, you know, we can work with you to help implement a good portion of the things that you're going to learn through the course and other things. So if you reach out to me, you can do it that way.
Hey, Mike, I'm feeling some kind of way, man. I might have to get in touch with you. How long does it take to roll over some assets and liabilities and stuff? How long does that take to roll over?
Well, when you
just say if somebody's with one company and you feel okay, but now you're looking at another company and you feel they might be a benefit, you know, to your rate of return for yourself. Sure. How do I get in touch? How long would that transition take place? So you say just per se.
For the moment that you say, I want to proceed. Like go forward. Like Charles said, there could be a process first before you get to the point to where it's just like, I'm ready to move, which is great. As a matter of fact, I love that. The more detailed, the more questions, the more interest, I love it. Because I know once you make the decision, it's a real decision.
Oh, yeah.
Not just excitement or energy. But yeah. Because of the way that my business is designed as an independent contractor, I don't work for any one company. I'm not married to any one company. I have multiple companies that are at my disposal that I'm appointed with. So literally the best that the companies have to offer, I have access to it. And so that's what I recommend to my clients. So once you decide that, Mike, I'd like to do this after I share with you, then within about a week, maybe 2 weeks, depending on the company where your money is coming from, depending on them, the transfer can happen very quickly. I've seen it happen as quickly as the same day.
Okay.
Within the time frame that they make transfer. So it depends on the company that the money's coming from.
So this is Wayne, and one thing that I'll say is, much like Charles, I've been I also work with Michael
Mr. Thompson, Wayne.
And so introduced by Charles, and so yeah, I transferred my insurance information, and so I'm happy with what you know a lot of the stuff that we've talked about, and so I just wanted to say that, not just to say that. This is the real deal, right? And Michael, everything that he's saying here, we've had conversations, not quite as many as Charles, but we've had conversations. And, you know, there's a lot of good information. And so I have nothing but positive things. And so anyone listening to this, anyone who has any interest, obviously get that course, obviously follow up with Michael Thompson. Sure. And if you like what he's saying, you know, make a move.
Let's say if my boy Wayne says this, then that's something to look into, because my boy is tight.
Yeah,
he's tighter than 2 pounds of bologna in 1 pound bag. So guess what? If he went with Michael, listen, my man tight with that money. So if he went with Michael, I'm telling y'all right now, you heard it first. listen, you heard it first. Goodness. If he
why went are you with telling Michael, everybody, Mike?
Because that's how you survived all these years, brother. And that's why you got my respect, because you know how to hold on to some money. But I'm going to tell you right now.
Call a divorce.
If you went with Mr. Thompson, a.k.a. Michael, listen, you got to look into it. Look that man up. I'm telling you, look him up.
No doubt. I appreciate no doubt.
That. Hey, and this is for the listeners that have been resistant on getting insurance. I, right now, can tell you, I don't have life insurance. But I bet you I'm going to get some real soon. Now, you know,
yeah,
of course,
that's what I'm talking about. And I'm
going to do it the right way. So, Mr. Thompson, you'll be hearing from me real soon.
I look
that's
forward to it.
Yeah,
that's what I'm talking about. Unity in the community. That's what I'm talking about, baby.
It's time to get my life in order, and as well as set up the family for success later on.
It's powerful.
Well, I'm
proud of you, Steph.
I'm deciding if I still want to be a part of this crew, because apparently they've been keeping you a secret from me. So we got some discussing to do after this podcast. So I'm just putting them on blast.
Well, I'm glad.
Where are we meeting them at?
You know, Mike's been busy,
Mr. Thompson.
Let me tell you something. Money's a tight and important situation. You don't want to just be telling somebody how to spend their money.
Oh,
no doubt. Everybody do their own thing.
Yeah, very sensitive, no doubt.
Yeah.
So, guys,
y'all.
any closing comments, questions for Michael before we let him go? I know we're a bit past our time, but I think it was time well spent for sure.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you, man. I appreciate your time, man. And like I said, it's always good seeing you. And every time we see you, you bring us to the next level every time. I mean, when we first met you, you brought us to a social media level. This time, we're talking about insurance, financial planning. So anytime we meet with you, you're always bringing us to the next level. You're always making sure that we're moving forward, and I appreciate it. And I just want to look forward to seeing you again.
And Mike, can we have you back on again? You know, let me tell y'all this. The next 3 to 4 months.
Let me tell y'all this.
Go ahead.
I have been invited to lots of different things, and I'm very selective about where I spend my time and who I spend my time with. And it's not because I'm on any other level, but I'm very specific because I believe your success is predicated on your surroundings and who you surround yourself with. And so I can tell all of you that the experience that I've had with meeting each one of you, you know, outside of this platform directly, I can tell you this is a group that I'm excited to be a part of. So anytime J-Bam and the J-Bam fam wants me, I will make time to make myself available to be here. So y'all just let me know, and I'll work it out on my schedule to make it happen. So it's not even a real long conversation. Just tell me when.
So Mr. Thompson, you know you're the only non-member that's made it to the website, right?
Are you serious?
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Yeah. I'm just saying, you know.
That's true.
Yeah, he's honorary. He's honorary.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's honorary right there.
That's right.
You had the Tesla hat on and everything.
We still got the picture. Hey, that's our promo. One of our promos. It's one of our promos.
People seen that thing. People seen it. It's out.
I'm in. No doubt.
Good stuff.
Hey, you know what? I wear my J-Bam t-shirt out in public, and people ask me all the time, what's that? And believe me, I'm talking about y'all all the time.
All right.
Let them know.
Appreciate that. All right. So real quick, Michael, just tell us one last time where folks can find you.
Absolutely. You can find me. Number one, you can go to gameoncapital.com and you can input your information. We'll capture it and you can schedule an appointment if you like. And I'll talk to you directly, or certainly someone capable to talk to you directly. That again is gameoncapital.com. To have access to the course, the one that I'm giving away for this audience, you go to blocks.gameoncapital.com and you'll be able to have access. We'll capture your information and we'll make sure that once it's officially launched prior to the public, we'll make sure that you get it. So gameoncapital.com, schedule an appointment, and blocks.gameoncapital will be able to get you that, we'll get you that course. And if you want to be very specific with reaching me, go to michael@gameoncapital.com, send me an email, and I'll get back at you.
Good deal, sir.
We definitely appreciate your time, man. It's been great.
Pleasure's all mine.
Indeed. It's been a pleasure. And you all have been watching the or listening to the Just Be a Man podcast, where we offer commentary from a man's perspective. Once again, check us out on our various social media platforms. Be sure to like, subscribe, share folks, you know, share this information with the folks in your lives, man. I mean, this was some good information tonight. Hopefully you got a lot out of it. So Mike, take us out.
All right, I would like to say thank you, folks. And usually I say deuces, and that means goodbye. But tonight, I want to say, if you missed this show, you missed out. Deuces.